Sharon Stratton of Edmonton, Alberta. This is your chance to win big thanks to Save on Foods Million Dollar Touchdown to win. If the kickoff is returned for a touchdown, you could win groceries for a year. If two are returned for touchdowns in this game, you could win $1 million. Let's get you to Dustin Nielsen and Glenn Suter.
A beautiful October evening in Edmonton, where Commonwealth Stadium plays host to a tale of two teams heading in opposite directions. The defending Grey Cup champions from Winnipeg have full control of the West. The home side tonight looking for answers. Losers of four in a row. The Elk season now officially hanging in the balance.
This is start number three for Taylor Cornelius out of Oklahoma State. This start different than the previous two, where he was filling in for an injured Trevor Harris. Tonight, Harris is a healthy scratch, not dressed. This is a coach's decision that at least for now makes Taylor Cornelius the starting quarterback in Edmonton. There's Zach Kolaris for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. He's having an MOP season, is leading the league in passing yards, and is off to an 8-1 start to the 21 campaign.
That 8-1 start is the best they've had under that man. Mike O'Shea can clinch a playoff spot with a win tonight. They have won six in a row. On the other side, Jamie Elizondo, four losses in a row here for the Elks. 0-4 at home this season as well. So needless to say, a huge, huge game for the home side tonight, as Winnipeg looking to take a clean sweep of a three-game set against Edmonton this week. Thank you very much for joining us. Friday Night Football from Commonwealth Stadium, and we are underway as Mortada lets it fly. Williams is going to take it just inside his own 10, back to the 15, now the 20 for Terry Williams, looking for some room on the far side of the field. Williams will take it up to the 35, and a return game that struggled for about half a decade, they'll certainly take that start.
Well, he's coming out of Oklahoma State. Taylor Cornelius, we know, has started two games, both losses for the Edmonton Elks this year. There are his numbers so far this season: 624 yards passing, three touchdowns to six interceptions. Went deep into the game against the Winnipeg Blue Bombers here a few weeks back, and then a couple of mistakes turned that game in the Bombers' favor.
They were leading midway through the third quarter in week seven right here in Cornelius' first ever start, and then the Bombers' defense does what the Bombers' defense does. They'll hand it off to Wilder. He had two touchdowns in that game here against Winnipeg in week seven, and he'll get the first touch here today. Let's take a look at the starting lineup for the Edmonton Elks, brought to you by Expedia.
Well, Kyle Saxwell had started at left tackle on the offensive line. He moved over to the right side, and now he's back at left tackle with Justin Renfrew playing the right side here tonight. And you mentioned James Wilder, who started this game, first running play for Edmonton. He's been doing his thing, second in the league in rushing.
Second and eight for Cornelius. He's going to swing it out to Williams. Williams with a completion, but he's wrapped up after a short gain. And it'll be a two and out to start here for Edmonton. Alden Darby making the play on Williams. So they run it with Wilder. They swing it out, trying to set something up for Williams.
Well, the question is, can they figure out and crack the code that is the Winnipeg Blue Bombers? Many teams have tried of late, and many teams have failed.
The Argos, the only team to beat the Bombers so far this season in what has been a terrific year for this Winnipeg squad. Grant takes that punt from Hugh O'Neill and steps out just inside his own 35, and that's where Zach Kolaris will get the start.
Well, I mentioned leading the league in passing yards, over 2,000 for Kolaris. He's 71% completion percentage, which is outstanding, and a great touchdown interception ratio. But most importantly, the Bombers sitting at 8-1 can clinch a playoff spot tonight with a win.
Full control of the West. Win tonight will put them four games up. They haven't been four games at the top of the West since 1962. So that's on the line tonight here for Winnipeg. Kolaris quickly goes to Lawler, and Lawler couldn't haul it in, and it'll fall incomplete on the first pass attempt of the game for Aiden White.
Kenny Lawler's back in the lineup, but you take a look at defensive line for, we'll get to the defense in a second for the Bombers, but that up in the receiving corps, Kenny Lawler gets back into the lineup. He was suspended for one game, and back the leading receiver after missing one game is is still the leading receiver in the Canadian Football League.
Over 700 yards receiving for Kenny Lawler. Pressure coming. Polaris felt it and had to get it away. Some good pressure there from Edmonton as they bring Jonathan Rose out of the secondary. And a nice start for the Edmonton defense.
Well, they're going to need this. I mean, this is going to be, it's got to be the script for Edmonton. Make sure you're on the right side of the turnover ratio here tonight against the best team in the league. Have your defense keep you in it for as deep and as long as they can, and then chip away at some points with a young quarterback and start number three in Taylor Cornelius.
Couple of two and outs to start this game. Williams will watch as this kick lands out of bounds just inside the 40. And that will be pretty good field position for that man. Taylor Cornelius will get the ball for a second time in place of Trevor Harris as the starting quarterback of the Edmonton Elks. Friday Night Football on TSN, proudly presented by The Brick, saving you more. Friday night to kick off the week. A couple of games tomorrow right here on TSN as well. Beautiful shot of Commonwealth Stadium as everybody watching Taylor Cornelius, and a huge opportunity here for this 26-year-old quarterback. One for one, had a completion just a yard to Williams earlier. Now he'll get it to Darrell Walker. Walker puts his head down, takes a pop from Alford, and gets about 5 yards on that first down catch. Here's a look at the Winnipeg defense.
Number one defense in the league. There's Stove, Steven Richardson. More on him and how he got that nickname later in the game. You're going to be surprised if you've Google searched and Wikipedia'd him. It's not correct. Adam Big Hill is the leader of their defense. 724 career defensive tackles. And the newcomer in the secondary, Demario Houston.
Pressured, and Cornelius steps up out of the pocket, lunges forward. Looks like he might come up just short of the first down, but Winnipeg managed to bring some heat there, and Cornelius did a nice job stepping up, finding a spot to escape there. But it is going to be third and one, and it looks as though Edmonton will kick this ball away, and the crowd here does not like it early, Glenn.
Yeah, they don't like it early, but this is a full yard. This may even be a little bit more than a yard. You've got the field position advantage, and you can continue to play the field position game here. I'm okay with this decision.
O'Neill kicks it away. And Grant reaches up and gets it after a 43-yard kick for O'Neill. Both offenses here on a Friday night looking to get on track. That guy will be involved, you know it. 150 yards last week for Andrew Harris. Now, he missed some time in the first part of the season, but he's been ramping it up ever since, and Andrew Harris really blew up last week.
Yeah, he is climbing the ladder in the rushing category and getting closer to the top and trying to once again the rushing leader at the end of the season. Williams Stanback is the leader so far, and number two to him is James Wilder. But big game last week for Andrew Harris. Got him back in the race.
Fourth consecutive time if he were to lead the league in rushing this year. And on cue, they will hand it off to him, and he'll push up towards the 15. Let's take a look at this Winnipeg offense tonight.
Well, Jamarcus Hardrick's out of the lineup on the offensive line, so that bumps Patrick Neufeld out to tackle, and Tui Eli will play at Neufeld's spot at guard. I mentioned Kenny Lawler back in the lineup. Number one receiver in the CFL after missing a game due to suspension is back, and that's a great group. Maybe the number one group in the entire league. Great balance in that receiving core for Zach Collaros.
No shortage of weapons there. Well, Witarski the only one without multiple receiving touchdowns on the year. Collaros pressured again. They're going to get to him, and they'll stop him inside the five, driving him back towards the end zone. Bieria, and an excellent start here for this Edmonton defense.
This is why I like the idea to punt.
Good point.
Third and one. Third and one, you play the field position game. Your defense just got a two and out, and they get a second two and out. And this play right here makes that decision by Jamie Elizondo the right one. Now either they give up a safety or great field position for Edmonton.
A lot of pressure from that Edmonton front four. Kolaris tried to escape the pocket, looking for somewhere to go, and waiting for him there was Keyshawn Vieira, the first year CFLer. And Jamie Elizondo has to be happy with this start from his defense as they have him on top 2-0, and not an easy week for Jamie Elizondo. Here's more on his decision to make this switch at quarterback.
First of all, it's a difficult decision because I care about Trevor, our relationship together. You know, we've been to battle together. So the easy decision here would be to stay with Trevor and say, I've gone to war with this guy. You know, we've had success. The harder decision is to say, I'm gonna go with a guy who's really playing his third CFL game. But my job is to make the best decision for the team.
Not an easy decision to make. He talked about how difficult it was for him considering the relationship that he has had with Trevor Harris. And Harris done a nice job here with Cornelius, helping him all throughout the week.
Yeah, I mean, very difficult decision. Remember, that relationship goes back to their days in Ottawa together, where Trevor Harris threw for over 5,000 yards a few years back with Jamie Elizondo as his OC. So, you know, you think about that relationship and how difficult the decision has been. But Trevor Harris had a tough outing last week. Less than 100 yards passing against the Bombers.
The ball will bounce to Williams, and Williams is hammered just outside his own 35, and that's where Cornelius will have an opportunity to start. One of the things Elizondo said there was he had to make this decision for the team. How much do you read into that, Glenn?
Well, it's part of it. You know, it's partly due to the performance that he actually pulled Trevor Harris last week, and looking at the overall picture. Now, in fairness to Harris, it wasn't too far removed that he went into Calgary, threw for over 404 touchdowns. So that's what made this such a difficult decision. But as of right now, Taylor Cornelius is the starting quarterback, not replacing him because he's injured. Coach's decision.
He'll hand it off to Wilder. Stopped in his tracks by Willie Jefferson. And Cornelius, we've seen a little bit of him so far in the Canadian Football League, and his 1 year as a starter in 2018 was massive.
Well, big game. I mean, that game, 501 yards passing, was against Oklahoma. The Sooners' starting quarterback was Kyler Murray that game. And he outdueled Kyler Murray. Didn't win it, lost by 1 point. It's an interesting story, but threw for more yards than Murray.
Second and 11 here for Cornelius. He's got a ton of time, and now he's going to look down the field. That's up for grabs and over the head of Shy Ross, who turned around looking for a flag. He wasn't going to get it, but Cornelius gunned that one in there, and Ross was unable to make a play on it in the second and 11. First incompletion of the game for Cornelius.
Well, it shows you Taylor Cornelius's arm strength, because he didn't really even step into this and launched it about 50, 60 yards. I mean, he's got pretty good time initially. Just takes a step and flicks it down there. Now, I'm not sure what Shy Ross was complaining about. There wasn't a defender grabbing him.
Well, it's Darby in coverage. Fifth consecutive two and out between the two teams to start this game, and now they're going to throw it across the field. Who's been an excellent addition to the team this year, defensively gets involved on special teams as well. 41 yards as Janarian Grant throws it over to him, and Alford, with a little bit of help, does the rest. Winnipeg down 2-0, looking for a spark, and they found it here on special teams.
Well, it looks like Edmonton has it drawn up exactly the way they want. They have the rush lanes, the cover lanes. Janarian Grant's caught in the corner, but what he does is take two steps, launches it with the left hand, a legal lateral, and look it. No Edmonton Eskimo cover player, or excuse me, Elks cover player inside.
Could have gone for a bunch more. They did a decent job getting back there. Now they'll hand it off to Harris, but we were talking about it. Edmonton's done a lot of good things here at the start of this game.
Yeah.
They have this lead, trying to control the field position. And one play, and Winnipeg snatches it all back.
Well, it was, you know, 2 points on the safety, good decision on the punt, good decision not to go on third and one, had the field position advantage, but a great call and great timing on the call has now flopped the field, and Zach Lars has a chance to put some points on the board.
9-yard pickup for Andrew Harris, and now they will push ahead, needing the 30 for the first down, and it does look like they got more than enough. Let's take a look at this Edmonton defense for tonight.
Well, the Elks need some leadership out of Kwaku Boateng, and a guy I think that many thought would be looking at an all-star season. It's been a real quiet one so far, but he can pick it up from here. Niles Morgan, already a couple of plays on defense in this one, leads their team with defensive tackles, and great interception against Winnipeg last week in Winnipeg for Jordan Hoover from that safety position.
In the end zone, and took it back down the field quite a ways. Now they'll hand it off again, and look at this push ahead. Andrew Harris taking a few Elks with him, and that is going to be another first down, or darn close to it. They might mark him just shy of it, as the Bombers just picked up the first down of the ball game.
Yeah, you gotta, as a tackler, get low on Andrew Harris. I mean, you're taking a chance because he could hurdle you, but he gets into that first level and then bounces to the linebacker level. If you try to hit him higher from waist up, he's gonna take you another 4 or 5.
We'll wrap up those thighs.
Get in down low around the knee and thigh area and cut him down.
McGuire back in to push ahead on third and short. That's a couple here that they picked up now. They were 13 of 15 on the year in that situation, and McGuire does a good job of taking care of business behind what is obviously an excellent offensive line for the Bombers.
Well, Michael Shea is real excited about Tui Eli in that guard, and thinks that he's just one of the group and one of these road graders, and they shouldn't really drop off, even though Jamarcus Hardrick is an all-star tackle. They'll move Patrick Neufeld, a U of S product, out there to tackle. He'll be just fine then.
First and 10, Winnipeg in the red zone. Polaris looks to the end zone, and that's going to be picked off, stepping in underneath Tremaine Washington, his third of the season, and he's going to bring it all the way back out to the 25 as the Edmonton defense comes up with a big play, and the Bombers are driving. Washington now has 3 interceptions on the season. The team just has 4. And this one, big. Washington watching, waiting, stepping in underneath the receiver and picking off Zach Kolaris. It's been an interesting week at the quarterback position here in Edmonton. For more on that story, let's send it down to Ryan Rashad.
All right, Dusty, I had a chance to speak, albeit off camera, with Trevor Harris yesterday, and he fully admitted he was completely blindsided by this decision, didn't see it coming at all. He didn't want to get too deep into how he felt about it. He didn't think that would be productive. What he did tell me is he did his best this week to be a good teammate. He stayed, you know, late after practice with Cornelius, working on video, trying to help him strategize. We see him on the sideline, he's engaged. But listen, this was tough for him to take. He made it clear that he's got nothing but love for his teammates and for Brock Sunderland, but that is where he left it. So relationships have been strained. Trevor Harris obviously disappointed, doing the best that he can to be a good teammate in this situation. But guys, the future very much up in the air with Trevor Harris and the Elks.
Well, you want to show people that you can be a good teammate in this situation, Glenn, if you're looking to continue to work somewhere else possibly, or here again in the Canadian Football League.
Yeah, and you expect nothing less, and I'm not surprised at all that Trevor Harris helped his teammates as much as he could, and Taylor Cornelius, who just completed a nice one on the sideline and helping him in the film room. But I'll tell you exactly how he feels. Even though he won't, he hates it.
he
absolutely hates the idea, but he's got to live with it right now, and what an opportunity for young Taylor Cornelius.
Trevor Harris, suck it up and help out while you can. And Cornelius now 4 for 5 as he goes back across to Mike Jones again, and that'll be another completion. Take them up close
to their own 45.
Yeah, I would call the play calling at this point conservative for Taylor Cornelius. I mean, he tried the one deep one with that, but that was when the play was actually sort of extended and he was just looking downfield in a sort almost a scramble drill.
Second and four for Cornelius this time. Three receivers to his left. Look to his right. Nobody was there. Escapes one tackle. Makes another man miss. And he's got a first down out at the 51. And this is something that they like from Cornelius. His ability, especially as a big man, to move and escape trouble.
Well, this is a type of run that earns you the respect of your teammates. And you saw Greg Ellingson right away after this run. He breaks the tackle right there of the Stove Richardson. And then a couple more, including Adam Big Hill for a first down.
First and 10, fresh set of downs on the 51. Now he'll drop it off for Fletcher. Fletcher is thrown down, and a little bit of a strut from Alden Darby.
Yeah, Alden Darby shoots the gap. I mean, he reads this one and then just shoots it. And this is what the defense can do. It pushes you in second along a bunch, but that last run by Cornelius, I thought it was an interesting reaction from the rest of his team on offense. Right there to congratulate him on a big run for a first down. See if he can convert on this second plus.
Second and long. Second and 13 here for Cornelius. Ellingson in the slot to his right, wide side of the field. Pressure coming. Cornelius rolls to his right, looks down the field, and that was almost picked off. A lunging effort from Brandon Alexander as he looked for his third pick of the year.
Well, this is the type of throw that he's got to get used to in the Canadian Football League, because when you roll out, the safety is going to be rolling with you. And if you don't count him, he's going to cut underneath. That's exactly what Brandon Alexander does. When Cornelius starts to roll, now it's not 11-man football, it's 12. There's an extra guy in the middle, and he's coming with you on that roll. So if you're going to throw it this deep across your body, that safety's coming across.
That kick blocked, and it will be controlled. There's a flag on the far side of the field. It eventually is gobbled up by Edmonton just outside their own 50. There was a flag on the play as Hugh O'Neill has been trying to get the punt game going for Edmonton this year. Couldn't get that one away cleanly.
No yards interference. Edmonton number 31. 15-yard penalty. First down, Winnipeg.
This will set up excellent field position for the Bombers.
Well, I didn't catch the number, but the Bomber special teams making an impact, and all of a sudden the third phase of the football team is stepping up.
Kolaris starts this drive on the Edmonton 37. He'll give it to Dembski. Dembski trying to find the edge. And there is a flag. And Dembski out of bounds. But is there a hold here? That'll back this thing up.
Holding, Winnipeg number 24. 10-yard penalty, still first down.
Long lateral on the return game, and now a blocked punt by Jesse Briggs off the edge, and he comes clean from the left side to block that punt. Partially block it anyway. It did cross the line of scrimmage, but he got his hands on it, creating the great field position. You still have to give 5 yards, so that was the penalty.
Looked like
backup
Fletcher
linebacker making a big play.
Looked like Fletcher had a chance to sort of pick him off there and then went with somebody else. Vala Briggs, who does have a touchdown on the season. He had a scoop and score in that game against Toronto, which actually was the only loss of the year for the Bombers. Kolaris has a completion on first and 20, and they'll get a couple yards back as he found Rashid Bailey, who comes into the year with almost 400 yards receiving.
You know, by the looks of the score against Edmonton last week, Winnipeg 30, Edmonton 3, you'd think that, you know, it was an overall dominant performance by the Bombers and a bad game across the board for the Edmonton Elks. It wasn't for their defense. And I know that looks weird when you put 30 on the board, but Edmonton kept their defense kept a minute for most of that game, and it was late in the game when Trevor Harris got running
but the score kind of piled up on him.
Second and 15. Polaris, guns went in there. It's not going to be enough for a first down, but should move them within field goal range as he goes back to Bailey once again.
Niles Morgan made a nice hit on that. He's been really contributing. That's an in-route, and on the in-route, you've got a linebacker coming inside out. We'll dig right there and watch 45 come over the top, not draw the penalty flag, but he touches him down by contact about a yard and a half short. Maybe 2 full yards short. This has been an adventure for the Bombers.
All season. All season. Ali Mortado, 1 of 4 last week. He is 4 for 5 on the year inside 40. This one from the right hash, and he got it. That one looked like it might fade, but it snuck inside the right uprights. And Winnipeg, at the end of the quarter, a 3-2 lead over Edmonton on the road. Mortada providing their only offense. Cornelius getting the start, 5 for 7 for Edmonton in place of Trevor Harris. Well, it took the entire quarter, but the Bombers did go on top 3-2 in what we are describing as a defensive battle here in Friday night football suits.
Yeah, you take a look at the Jets versus the Oilers, and we've got a 3-2 score. Now, you know what? It was good defense, and again, that's going to have to be the formula for the Elks to try and knock off the top team in the league at 8-1 coming in the Bombers, and that's going to be to play good defense, keep it close. That interception when Zach Kolaros was throwing it to the end zone was huge for Edmonton to, you know, keep this close and let their young quarterback find his legs and, you know, try and get into a rhythm, get some confidence.
It's the third time they played. In the other two first quarters, Winnipeg actually outscored Edmonton 23-0. So it's the first time all year that Edmonton has put up points in the first quarter against Winnipeg. And there's a completion for a first down as they get it out into Greg Ellingson's hands, and he pushes ahead for a 14-yard pickup.
Three receivers to the wide side of the field, and people sometimes wonder, when these plays don't work, they wonder, why do you run these plays so much, these conservative little throws right along the line of scrimmage? This is why. This is why, because if you get a couple of blocks, you get a big chunk on a little screen pass like that.
First and 10 for Cornelius on his own 49. Wilder, nowhere to go. Casey Sales was there to meet him as he got his hands on that ball.
You know, one thing that stands out with Taylor Cornelius is his demeanor. You know, I think that if you're watching the pregame show too, I think that interview before the game started with Ryan Rashog on the sideline said it all. I mean, he, very few words, very composed, and, you know, almost like it didn't matter, but that's not the case. I mean, he's played on the big stage too. Oklahoma State, 80,000 plus.
Second and 10, and he guns that one in, waiting for it on his knees, Tavon Smith, and it'll be enough for a first down for Edmonton.
This is an example of the 6'5", 232-pound quarterback with a heavy throw. I mean, this is a heavy ball, and he told us on the Zoom call this week that he's got to know when to put that weight behind it and the zip behind it, and when to maybe use a little touch.
He zipped that one in there, first and 10. Now quickly gets it out to Darrell Walker. Walker working one-on-one, and Walker will push his way up close to another first down as they quickly moved it right in front of DeAndre Alford.
So let's go back to his college days in Oklahoma State. This was the big game against the Sooners. 48-47 was the final. Kyler Murray was the starting quarterback for Oklahoma in this game. And Taylor Cornelius comes all the way back. He throws for over 500 yards. Murray that day threw for 349 yards. That was the big comeback touchdown throw. The only reason they didn't win that game, or at least tie it, was because they went for two and didn't get the two-point convert at the end there. But went toe-to-toe with Kyler Murray, and it was quite the performance.
Oklahoma 8-1 at the time. Winnipeg 8-1 here tonight as they'll hand it off to Wilder, and he'll push ahead, and that's a fresh set of downs for Cornelius. And will they leave him back on the sidelines? They will. They have done this earlier in the season with Cornelius, and they bring out Prukop for some short yardage and then leave him in. And it could be a momentum zapper, but let's see what they've got drawn up here.
Well, Jamie Elizondo said that this was the combination. This is part of the reason for Trevor Harris not starting or not dressing.
And that one, they knew it was coming. Winnipeg was all over it. Jackson Jeffcoat, he read that extremely well. And when you leave Prokop in there, I think most of the time this defense is going to be thinking some sort of run. And they read it well.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, a run defense that allows less than 100 a game and top-ranked defense. But we will see different play packages with Dakota Prukop at quarterback tonight.
Second and 12 for Cornelius. Quarterback draw right up the middle. Cornelius trying to pick his way down, looking for a first down. He's going to slide short, even with that 6'5" frame. He tried to lunge ahead, but he will come up just shy of what he needed.
Well, this is a good change up. You put Dakota Prukop out there and then change him on second and long. Go ahead and run it, guys. And then you say, well, he can run too. Our other quarterback, our starter, and Taylor Cornelius can run as well. In that game, Oklahoma State versus Oklahoma, the game before he played against the Longhorns and had two rushing touchdowns, three touchdown passes in a win against Texas. So he can run it too.
And he set up Sean White in a pretty good spot straight away for White from 34, and that one is good. Dead center there for Sean White. 86% on the year. Well, one of our teammates, legendary Canadian broadcaster Rod Black, announcing that he's moving on this week.
Yeah, and of course, on behalf of all of us at TSN, boy, we wish him the best in anything that he goes after in his future. But one of the most versatile, outstanding broadcasters in North America in sports, I think. You know, when you think about what he covered top to bottom, from figure skating one night to baseball the next and Canadian football after that, such an important role that he has had in growing the game of Canadian football. Rod Black had so much passion for Canadian football, especially telling the Canadian stories of the Canadian kids playing in the league. And we'll miss him, but we wish him the best moving forward in his career. And boy, I tell you what, he gave as much time as any fan wanted when he'd walk out of a game and out of a stadium as well. So I know a lot of fans have had great experiences with Rod Black. We wish him the best.
Many people have a Rod Black story. For me personally, as a radio host as well, he's one of the favorite guests to have on. He's the best. Rod Black's the best. Absolute best. 5-3 is where we are at here right now with 10:51 remaining in the second. For Winnipeg, I mean, the majority of your field position has actually come from special teams.
Yep, absolutely.
So offensively, you know, they've sputtered a little bit to get going here. Polaris with time has a completion on the far side of the field. He goes back to Bailey again. And Rasheed Bailey has been his go-to guy. Fourth target and another completion. All three of the quarterback's completions have been to 88.
Has been some pressure, though. I think this is a game that Zach Lars has faced sort of more pressure early on in a game than he has in some time. I think that a little bit of pressure off the edge from Kwaku Boateng forced the interception by Tremaine Washington in the end zone. And it almost looked like he rushed that throw, too.
First and 10 on the 43, and they hand it off. And once again, that Edmonton front four doing a very good job to make sure it goes nowhere.
In his 100th game as a Winnipeg Blue Bomber, the Mountain Stanley Bryant from East Carolina, in his 11th season in the Canadian Football League, he plays his 100th game as a Bomber, 166th in the Canadian Football League. And when we talked to him this week, that quote, that just had us all laughing. You know, he goes, you know, we do more than just eat. Because my first question to him was, do you guys, you know, spend a lot of time together, even though with the protocols, the big old line? He goes, you know, we do more than just eat.
Then he also confesses up for the cake.
talked about visiting the keg here in Edmonton with his teammates. But, and how he loves a steak. I think, in fact, he described exactly how he liked his steak to you.
New York cake classic with prawns on it, if I recall correctly. Five-time All-Star. I mean, there's a reason that the Bombers lead the league in rushing most years, and he's a big part of it.
And this O-line has allowed 9 sacks in 9 games. That is unbelievable.
We'll hand this one off after a couple of plays involving Dembski, this time back to Harris, and this is the best offensive drive that Winnipeg has put together so far this evening.
Just for contrast, Edmonton's offensive line, with all their changes and different combinations, has allowed 22 sacks to this point in the year, a game less than the Bombers. But that Bomber O-line is allowing just 1 sack per game.
Take this ball right up the gut, down to the Edmonton 40 for a fresh set of downs. 7-yard pickup for Harris.
And this is the other part. I mentioned the sacks allowed, but the road graders up front will also do this for Andrew Harris. And whether it's a hole or not, he's not finding or feeling contact till he gets 6 yards past the line of scrimmage. I mean, that doesn't necessarily have to be a big hole in one of the gaps. If you just push the D line backwards, you give your running back room to go.
This one will fall incomplete. Looking out to the far side of the field for Kenny Lawler. And Lawler never really had a chance to make a play on that one.
Boy, those big guys, though, they take so much pride in protecting the quarterback and Stanley Bryant.
Didn't you ask him this week, what do you take more pride in, the rushing or the fact that you've only allowed 9 sacks? And he said, can I take both?
Yeah,
that's what he wanted.
I want both. Yeah. I want both. I want open holes for our back in Andrew Harris. But man, I got to protect that guy. And he's got the blind side with a right-handed quarterback.
2nd and 10. Kolar's in trouble here.
Well, he's going the opposite side. Stanley Bryant is on the left side, and this is coming from the backside right here. This is on Patrick Neufeld, and again, he's sliding out from his guard to play that tackle spot. Now he should be okay, but that one just went around the edge. Costigan gets home. There's their 1 sack allowed per game.
This will be kicked away. And it will bounce at about the 15 and head out of bounds, and Terry Williams never to make a play on it. Zach Kolaris under pressure. Doesn't happen very often, but Edmonton got to him there, and they lead 5-3. CFL on TSN continues tomorrow with a doubleheader. Action is kicked off by an East Division showdown between the Owls and Red Blacks, followed by a West Division battle between the Stamps and the Lions. It all gets underway at 4 Eastern, 1 Pacific, and keeps rolling all night long, only on TSN. Friday night football here this evening. Cornelius, 8 of 10 for 60 yards. Also has 19 yards rushing. His team on top here, 5-3, midway through the second quarter. They'll go to Wilder. He's been quiet, and once again, no room for Wilder to bust loose.
Well, speaking of quiet, number 87's having a quiet season. And, you know, we talked to him this week as well, a little bit frustrated with, you look at the last few weeks, just 3 catches for 25 last week, 2 for 34 versus Winnipeg early on. A couple of catches and a few targets each game. It's just not sort of Darrell Walker numbers. And is still looking for his first touchdown of the season.
He's never gone this
long. Illegal formation
without a major.
This penalty is declined. It's second down.
Yeah, we asked him that this week about how long has it been since, or is this the longest it's been since you've scored a touchdown in a season? And he said, yeah, going back to as long as I can remember, it's been a long wait to find the end zone. And, you know, I got the sense, I don't want to put words in his mouth, but I got the sense that with the big arm that Taylor Cornelius possesses, he's looking forward to seeing what the kid can do, and if he can get him the ball maybe down the field a couple times.
He's been targeted 23 times in the last 3 weeks, but it's caught just 7 of them. Cornelius finds some room, dumps it off over the top, reaching out for it with one hand was Ellingson. And he was in full sprint and couldn't control it.
Yeah, he had to really hustle. He had to dig in and get across. Now, again, Cornelius, nice little throw here on the run, but just outside the reach of Greg Ellingson. Greg Ellingson started on the far side of the field, came all the way across. That's a 65-yard wide field. Cornelius just missed him. Maybe a little more touch on that throw, leading him out in front with a little air under it might have helped.
Dietrich Nichols in pursuit there of Ellingson. O'Neal is going to kick this away. 44-yard kick is brought back by Grant down inside the Edmonton 50. In pretty good field position here for that man. 4 of 8 on the night. Great start to the season for Mike O'Shea. He's got his Bombers at 8-1. For more on the head coach, let's send it down to Ryan Rashad.
Well, Dusty, one of the things he loves the way this team does is identifying their own mistakes and correcting them themselves. You know, often it doesn't even make it into the film room because he knows they've taken care of it. It's a veteran group. He lays the foundation down, and when mistakes are made, he says that this leadership is so fast to self-correct. He joked and said there's a lot of days I'm kind of not really sure if I'm needed down there. But it's a veteran group that knows when things go wrong that it's on them to fix it, and they often do it before he has to say a word, guys.
You know things are going well when coach says he's not even sure what he's supposed to be doing. And there's a flag in the secondary as this ball was completed. And an excellent effort by Lawler there to stay on his feet after the completion from Zach Kolaris. That's the first catch of the day for Kenny Lawler.
It's interesting because we've talked to
illegal interference blocking downfield. Winnipeg number 10. This is a 10-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
Yeah, when Zach Kolaris got outside, I think Nick Dembski thought that he was going to run the ball, and so he started to try and find a block downfield, but he was still behind the line of scrimmage, the quarterback, still looking to throw it. So, but it's interesting that Coach O'Shea said that. We get to talk to O'Shea every time we do a Bomber game, obviously, and you know, more than once he's brought up the fact that he loves a veteran team.
Yep.
And he doesn't mind, like, having a couple of rookies sprinkled in, but especially good ones like he's gotten his secondary this year. But he loves a veteran team, and that's what a veteran team will do. Take ownership.
Absolutely admires Adam Big Hill. And there is a pass on the far side to Lawler that falls incomplete.
Don't say that very often this year. A pass attempted to Kenny Lawler that went incomplete. Still leads the league after missing a game. Mikey Whitehead now out for a few weeks with an injury. That's the totals coming into this weekend. Brian Burnham will see tomorrow night. Kamar Jordan is close to a return. Won't play for Calgary tomorrow, but very close.
4 touchdowns on the year for Lawler. That's tops on the Bombers. Polaris on the run here. Looking down the field, has a ton of room. He's going to let one fly, and that is complete. Kenny Lawler on cue, slides underneath it. Biggest play of the game for Winnipeg.
Go tempo here, try and catch him off.
Seven-yard pickup for Kenny Lawler. And Kolaris is not happy right now.
Flag on the play. Play wasn't started.
Hold on. Play wasn't started anyway.
Well, scramble drills, you got to find an open spot. Lawler's at the number one spot right out in the wideout. Now, he's going down the sideline, but he sees his quarterback in trouble, so he's rushing and rolling to his right. He's going to head that way also and gets in front of Jonathan Minson. Love how he declared that he had the ball immediately as he rolled around, put it up in the air to let the official know.
Let me know. I got it. It's the longest play of the year, longest catch of the year for Lawler. They go to Harris now. Harris, there's that little spin move. And he takes it down inside the 5-yard line. A nice push ahead there by that offensive line.
Boy, the timing, though, on Zach Collaros' ability to escape, just crucial to that big play down the field. And then time to, especially on first down, see Andrew Harris gets that spin, another spin, got to get him down low.
Second and four with the ball sitting on the Edmonton 5. Collaros dumps it off. He's got Harris, and Harris is going to walk into the end zone. Touchdown, Winnipeg. Andrew Harris finishing off the drive, and now slow to get up as his team does go on top.
Yeah, he crossed the goal line awkwardly. Almost like he was trying to. He starts in the backfield and he'll just sneak out of the backfield here. But watch how he kind of stumbles and then awkwardly dives in the end zone like he was trying to not step on that or put any weight on his right leg.
Rose with the hit at the end of the play, but it looked like he was in pain
before he got to the hit.
Before the hit, yes. Kind of got turned around there to make the catch, which finished off a 5-play, 48-yard drive that had the 10-yard penalty that backed him up along the way as well. But he is up with a little bit of a limp. Now that's not good news for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. Harris, who, like we said, missed time at the beginning of the year, but has been getting better and better as things ramp up here for Winnipeg.
The limp is getting better and better as he gets closer there, too, so that's a good sign.
He'll likely get looked at and see if he can slide back in. He is smiling, and why not? That's another touchdown for Andrew Harris. First receiving touchdown of the year at 3 rushing touchdowns already. And of course, a huge week last week, 24 carries, 150 yards, and 2 touchdowns against Edmonton. 5 1,000-yard seasons under that man's belt. Mortada for the extra point, and that one is good. And the Bombers now with a 10-5 lead. Collaros finds Harris. Harris finds the end zone, and Bombers on top.
All right, gentlemen, a couple options here for halftime. We can talk about the Elks defense, the Bombers DBs, and Taylor Cornelius, or we can show everyone live Hanson. See you after the game. Cornelius. We're going to Hanson.
I think that's how it goes. Look, I'm not going to sit here trying to be cool. I mean, I'm pretty excited to see Hanson at halftime. So you stay here and enjoy it with me, or?
Sure. I'll keep it.
I know you're a country music guy.
I'm a country guy, but I'll keep an open mind. I'm okay with it.
His kick will bounce out of bounds at around the 11.
That's good field position for Taylor Cornelius.
Let's see if
he can find an answer here.
First down, Edmonton at the 45-yard line.
That's a 45-yard.
That's a big one.
Yeah, that's a big miss on the kick because it puts it at the 45-yard line and a couple of first downs away from at least a field goal to answer that touchdown from Andrew Harris.
What have you thought of his first half so far?
Well, I think it's been conservative play calling. You know, a lot of wide receiver hitch screens and short throws. And at some point, they're going to have to cut him loose. But you know, that requires an extra steamboat back there, and that's a pretty good D-line. So
down by five. They'll start on their 45 with just under 3 minutes to play. Cornelius in trouble this time. He's got nowhere to go as they get home again. And it's Stove Richardson tracking down 15 in green.
Wow. He gets there quickly, and this is what I mean about the Stove. When he gets down in that low stance and is so hard to get blocked up, he just ran right past David Beard.
He almost came free, like barely touched it all on the play. Second sack of the year for Richardson. Second and 16 now for Cornelius. They're gonna bring the heat again. He's in trouble again, but he stays up.
First, he's going to chip the Stove, help in the protection, and then he gets out and presents the target. So 32 is going to step in, and he sees the Stove, so he gives him a little chip to help his center. Then he gets out, presents a target when Cornelius is scrambling, and gets a 19-yard gain and first down.
Work on the Winnipeg 52. Cornelius again wants to go downfield. Now he'll take underneath, and that's going to be complete. Look down the field and decides to go to Jalen Tolliver, who he was with in the XFL in the past, and 88 holds it in.
Yeah, DeAndre Alford has the deep route covered, and that was Darrell Walker deep. So Cornelius turns, he sees the deep guy covered, and he drops it in the hole.
Still a 16-yard pickup as he creeps towards 100 yards passing in the first half. This time, and they'll give it to Wilder, and look at this, that's his best work of the evening on the ground. A huge burst right up the middle from James Wilder.
And here, a big answer. This is a huge answer, no matter how this ends, other than a turnover, but no matter how it ends, if points are attempted here by Edmonton to come back from the touchdown. I mean, you're playing the best team in the league, the dominant Winnipeg Blue Bombers, who just scored a touchdown, and now you're moving it down the field, answering that.
14 for Wilder. He had 5 yards on five carries prior to that. Back to Wilder again, and this time his legs are going to be wrapped up from behind, but still a positive pickup on first down.
That's a big call for Jamie Elizondo, his young quarterback, to convert here, keep hope alive for a major on the drive. Early in the year, they had problems in the red zone, seemed to have corrected that.
8 for 17 coming into the game in the red zone, 47%. Second and six for Cornelius here. Four receivers to his right. Looks to his right. Pressure again up the middle. Jefferson in pursuit. Cornelius waiting. Tried to dump it off again to Wilder. But this time, it was knocked down by the Bombers' defense. Kyrie Wilson making the play. That'll bring up third down.
You know, he's showing his more mobility, but Taylor Cornelius to his left was, he had to get that left shoulder, that lead shoulder around, and he tries to do it here with Kyrie Wilson in his face, and Wilson just gets his hand on it. Again, trying to dump it to James Wilder, who was open. But a real positive drive for Edmonton to put what should be a chip shot for Sean White. He's been excellent this year, over 80%.
25-yarder from White, and that is good. He is 2 for 2 on the night. Don't miss the return of the Emmy-winning series Critics Call, one of the best shows in HBO history, Succession. New season Sunday, October 17th, only on Crave.
Pretty
one of the best
active
in HBO history.
Well, pretty active area around our hotel today here in Edmonton. There was an HBO series being filmed right out in front of our hotel, and I think in a wedding that there was bride and groom went by, and it's really cool.
Everything's happening.
Well, I was looking at the HBO set, and I said, what's happening here? What's the series? And then I turned and looked at the married couple, and I said, why? No, I'm just kidding. Totally kidding. Totally kidding.
I know our wives are watching.
No, I said,
we love
congratulations.
We love you.
I said, congratulations.
There is the handoff. And that is Brady Oliveira with a good carry, his first touch of the game.
Boy, if you were just joining us, you thought that Andrew Harris changed jerseys to wear number 20. You looked a lot like him there.
Now we got multiple flags on the field. I count three at least on the Winnipeg side of the 50.
Stanley Bryant really trying to convince the official.
Procedure. Winnipeg number 59. 5-yard penalty. Remains first down.
But the defense moved first.
Hey. Carry from Oliveira. Puts him over 200 yards on the ground on the season. Of course, carrying the heavy workload early on when Harris was out to start the year. He remains in there now to the left of Kolaris. Pressure coming, Kolaris. They're going to get home again. Moncrief coming around. And he was there first. They might have had him either way. There was a couple of guys right in the face of Zach Kolaris.
Yeah, this was an all-out race. This is a situation where you got one here and one there, and who can get there first and get the stack? Unblocked. On the play, Moncrief from the left, and Niles Morgan from the top of your screen. Two linebackers coming out of the blocks to try and get home, and did.
First sack of the season for Moncrief, first in his return to the Canadian Football League. Sets up second and 20 now for Winnipeg. And they're going to hand it off. Oliveira right up the middle again. He's almost going to get it. Holy smokes. Two huge touches. This one's going to be good for 18, and it'll set up a third and short on Edmonton's side of the field.
Boy, he just keeps a nice low center of gravity so that any early contact he can just bounce off of. Looks like Niles Morgan had a shot at him. Pierre got blocked up pretty nicely by Tui Eli. First guy over to congratulate him is the starter, Andrew Harris.
Brings up third down and a long two, so looks like they are going to kick this away with Mark Leggio. He stands at his 45.
Boy, if you're Edmonton, massive underdog coming into this game tonight, you're pretty happy with this first half.
Williams takes this at his own 18. Ends it back up close to the 20 with 11 seconds on the clock. We've got halftime on the way, just a matter of moments with Kate in the panel. I wonder if they're going to bring up those faces again that they had in the pregame show. I thought that was pretty good.
Well, how do you cover those beautiful faces in a promo? I mean, I don't have to say that about Milt. He'll do all that on his own.
Interested to see how they break this one down. As you mentioned, I mean, Edmonton's got to be pretty happy with this first half against a Bombers team that's been absolutely steamrolling over most of the opposition so far this season. They're down just two with Cornelius at quarterback, and they'll hand it off to Wilder, who will secure that football and take it outside the 20.
Well, you know, a good first half and a good final drive, not this one, but the drive just before this, after the Bombers score.
Yeah.
And Cornelius puts together a nice drive, moving it down, using his legs, buying some time, a couple of completions, that little pass to Wilder that turned into a first down. That's something you can build on for the second half.
Final play of the half is another carry for James Wilder Jr. How much does he get involved in the second half of this ball game? A defensive battle between these two clubs, and Winnipeg being tested by Edmonton. They lead 10-8 at halftime. Let's send it back to Kate and the panel. Well, ask him when I'm
Continue our musical halftime now with Davis Sanchez. Give us a ballad, Davis.
If I was to tell you that Zach Collaros and Taylor Cornelius would have the same amount of yards passing, I think you'd be pretty happy if you're a member of the Edmonton Elks. Let's give credit to that Elks defense. Noel Thorpe has them boys flying around.
Here is our Ryan Rashog with Kenny Lawler.
Well, Kenny, offensively, both sides maybe struggling to get the ball downfield in that first half. What did you sense from your offense? It started to come a little bit later.
We just kind of get our feet settled, just trying to get in the groove of things. We know we just got to get first downs on first downs, and when we get first downs on those first downs, we make plays. So that's all we got. We got to stay on the field. We got to keep the energy up and just keep moving.
Big 47-yard reception for you, one of the biggest of the year. That's got to feel good in a tight game like this to haul one like that in. Tell us about it.
Yeah, man. It just gives the guys energy, give the offense energy, and it puts us in the red zone. Once we get in the red zone, we know we can make plays, and that's what we did with Andrew right there, sir.
Appreciate your time.
No problem. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
2-point lead for Lawler and the Bombers. They're rocking out tonight at Commonwealth Stadium. We will get you back there for second half action after this.
Leading the Edmonton Elks 10-8 at halftime. That Edmonton defense hanging tight right now. And for more on that, let's send it to Ryan Rashog with Tremaine Washington.
Well, Tremaine, Jamie Elizondo said, score aside, he was proud of the way the defense played last game against Winnipeg. You've held them to 10 points here in the first half. What do you think you're doing well?
We just getting after it. We know we're not worrying about the record. You know what I'm saying? We're just trying to put the pieces to the puzzles, put it together, and just ball out.
The team has 4 interceptions this year. You have 3 of them. Have you ever ball hawked like this in a year?
Yes. I'm known for being a ball hawk, ball magnet, just trusting my technique, just being coachable, listen to the coach and go make plays.
Thanks for this.
Thank you.
Well, one less thing to worry about here for Tremaine Washington and the rest of that Edmonton defense, and there is the limp and the track suit of Andrew Harris. So it looks like it's going to be Brady Oliveira the rest of the way for Winnipeg.
Yeah, and you can see in the right leg in the track suit, he's got a brace on that knee. So whether it's precautionary or not, we'll get more after the game, I'm sure. But Brady Oliveira, the rest of the way.
And he missed it. Harris injured himself, scoring the only touchdown of this game. Now here's a return for Denarian Grant. It's a good one. Takes it almost out to his own 40 and some solid field position for Zach Collaros and the Winnipeg offense. The Edmonton defense, pretty solid work there in that opening 30 minutes.
Well, we mentioned off the top that this great Winnipeg O-line was only giving up 1 sack per game, 9 sacks after 9 starts. They gave up 2 in the first half, and Zach Collaros threw an interception again, something uncharacteristic in the red zone. So a couple of sacks in that first half from Noel Thorpe's group. They're fired up, and they've got to play their best game to try and keep pace with the best team in the Canadian Football League. And got a whole half to play, and they've got some explosive players. So see what they can get ready for and right up for the second half. All about adjustments.
Winnipeg is 6-0 when leading at halftime. The Elks 0-5 when trailing at halftime, and they're going to have to find some sort of adjustment to slow down Brady Oliveira, who's come into this game and made a big impact since taking over for Andrew Harris.
Well, they better not relax that Edmonton defense on Brady Oliveira, because he is, he is sort of the spitting image of Andrew Harris. Got young legs, fresh legs, so they can't go to sleep on him. He's had some good runs since replacing Harris.
Oliveira's 5'10", 227. Harris listed at 5'10", 216. So maybe even a little bit thicker, if that's possible. Now they'll give it to Denski. Nick Denski's got all the room in the world. He's going to take it up to the midfield. Mark, and then step out around the 50 as they try to get Nick Denski involved in the offense. That's his second carry of the ball game.
Well, this is a play that you have to get contain on. If you don't get contain on this play, it's goodbye Dembski to the races. He gets the corner, and now it's the linebacking corps trying to run him down, and Derek Moncrief. But running up the middle on first down, fly sweep on second down. Nice play calling by Buck Pierce.
First and 10 on the Edmonton 50. Polaris moves it quickly, and that will be complete. Lawler almost dropped it, but he brought it back up to his hands and held on, takes it down for a 25-yard pickup for Kenny Lawler.
Yeah, soften up the defense with a couple of runs and then go play action with Lawler on the quick slant. This is also a blitz beater type of play.
I'll hand it off to Oliveira, and this time he is stuffed after a short pickup. Over 70 yards now for Kenny Lawler on just a couple of catches.
Hey, he double clutched it, but he hung on. Another catch on the slant. The Elks load the line of scrimmage, and Zach Polaris was expecting blitz. He got it, and he hit Lawler on the blitz beater.
Second and 9 on the Edmonton 24. Polaris, three receivers to his right. Some early movement here, and four flags fly. Everybody saw it. And a discussion as Coach O'Shea watches on.
Offside. Edmonton number 96. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
But a second and much more manageable situation after Mike Moore's offside penalty.
Mike Moore, it's a quiet night for him so far. A couple sacks on the season. He was a West Division All-Star back in 2019. And as Glenn mentioned, now a second and 4 situation here for the Winnipeg offense.
Based on the reaction, it looked like it may be roughing the passer. I didn't see the hit, but the reaction from the Elk defender.
Major foul, roughing the passer. Edmonton, number 95. Half the distance to goal, automatic first down.
Costigan, who had a sack in the first half, will get another look at this.
95 right there. Tight end formation with Miller. Way late. Got pushed in a little bit from Jeff Gray, but it doesn't matter if you get pushed. You have to avoid contact on the quarterback once the ball leaves his hand. That was the right call. And a new set of downs for the Bombers.
I think Washington was already engaged with Kolaris there as well, and then the extra pop from Costigan.
Bombers have their tight end group in there right now, and it looks like
Edmonton is challenging the ruling of the field of roughing the passer. The play will be reviewed.
So Jamie Elizondo has decided to challenge this. He's won 3 of 7 challenges. We'll see if he can get this one. Jets on TSN coverage begins Tuesday as the Jets head to Minnesota to take on the Wild. The action gets underway at 6:30 Central on TSN3 in the Jets region. And this is a long decision. And obviously a huge moment in this ball game as well, as Elizondo decided to challenge the roughing the passer call.
There was clearly a push in the back. I mentioned it with Jeff Gray. It's just a matter of, was avoidable contact from Costigan? Because, you know, whether you're thrown into the legs of a quarterback, I've seen that before, and if you can avoid hitting him, you're not called. If you get thrown into his legs, can't avoid hitting him, you can be called for roughing the passer. We'll see what they do here, but it was sort of a bang bang push and hit at the same time.
You saw right away when Costigan got up, he was like, yeah, he was pushed in. And
after review, the ruling on the field is overturned.
Ooh.
It'll be third down at the 19-yard line.
Well, we've seen times when a guy has been thrown into the legs of a quarterback where he still is penalized, but it looks like the command center has decided that it was so close. Jeff Gray with the hit. Costigan gets pushed after this contact. And he was going down at the same time, too.
The challenge pays off for Jamie Elizondo. And it now sets up a 27-yard field goal attempt for Mortada. And this one right down the middle. And he is now 2 for 2 on the night. But limited damage there.
Absolutely.
Edmonton. Obviously frustrating for Winnipeg.
You know, very, very good challenge. I've seen many times throughout the last few years a player getting pushed or thrown into a quarterback still gets called. It's not overturned. That one was. And I can only imagine that it was so close that Costigan was right in front of Kolaros when he got pushed in the back and therefore couldn't avoid that.
There's no room to get out of the way.
There was no room to move, yeah.
13-8, Winnipeg leads on the road Friday night football here on TSN. Thank you very much for joining us. Cornelius, that one's high! And Walker never had a chance to make a play on it. Jones reached up, but I don't think he was going to haul that one in. So zip on that one and missed everybody.
Yeah, and that was really the first sort of throw that was off. Like it was, you know, that just he just missed. It was an overthrow. It was a heater. It was coming out of there. But we talked to him about that, mentioned in the first half that, you know, he's got to understand when to put a little touch on it as well. And the receiver's got to get ready and get used to it.
Cornelius was 10 of 14 in the first half for 95 yards. Early here now in the third quarter, he faces a second and 10. Had some time, but underthrows Darrell Walker on the far side of the field.
Boy, the struggles really continue between whomever's playing quarterback and Darrell Walker. He'll end up running that out route. He's the single receiver, one-on-one, and he's got separation. Now, that's not on Walker. You know, this is an overcompensation from a young quarterback. He throws one well over the head of the receiver and then says, oh, I'm going to take a little off it, takes too much off, and one hops it.
Couple of misses for Cornelius. It's the fifth two and out of the game. 50-yard kick from O'Neill, and Grant will take it back just outside his own 30. Winnipeg with a lead. We'll have the ball when we return. Well, 13-8, a low-scoring game here. Some numbers that might surprise you a little bit with where these two teams are in the standings. Edmonton's actually done pretty well compared to Winnipeg in some of these categories.
Well, that one, 212 yards per game, is first in the league. And so is, you know, you take a look at that, and that might surprise, because Winnipeg does have the best team and the best defense, but when you look at the points allowed, that's where it jumps off the page, and that's where the difference lies.
All-time good defense in Winnipeg this year. As Oliveira pushes ahead, he's averaging 10 yards per carry prior to that one.
Well, and here's the thing, and here's the challenge for Edmonton. Right now, the Bombers still have the lead in the ball. It's a third quarter. If they get to the fourth quarter with the lead, it's game over, lights out. I mean, they have outscored their opponent, the Bombers, 81-6 in the fourth quarter, only allowing two field goals all season long. So you don't want to be behind the Winnipeg Blue Bombers going into the fourth quarter.
One of those field goals was here by Sean White back in week 7. As this is a completion, Oliveira again getting involved in the passing game, and that's going to be enough for the
first down.
A lot of different looks from the Barmer offense. They're going to bring in this play, they're going to bring in Dembski to help out with some pass protection because there's an adjustment. Remember the double blitz from Niles Morgan and Derek Moncrief in the first half when they both went off each edge? Well, this is their way to combat that. Bring in Dembski to help out in the blocking assignment.
They'll hand it off. And Oliveira pushes ahead for a few yards. 3-yard pickup and first down.
So Buck Pierce makes the adjustment to bring in blockers for Zach Kolaris. Then Noel Thorpe says, okay, here's what we do next. We show the blitz because Buck Pierce is saying, okay, I'm going to bring in max protection. And then the defense goes, okay, now I'll move my pawn to rook four and get those linebackers to show the blitz and then jump out of there.
Chess match happening here at Commonwealth on a Friday night. There's another completion. Kolaris starting to heat up here in the third quarter as he goes back to Kenny Lawler for his third catch of the game.
So right now, Noel Thorpe is sticking with it. So he's saying, I'm going to keep blitzing. There's one coming from offside of your screen, too. So I'm going to keep blitzing. Kolaris brings in more protection, leaves Oliveira in for protection, and that's your quick slant blitz breaker coming on that Lawler inside throw for a 10-yard gain. If you show blitz and drop your linebacker under that throw, you might get a pick.
First and 10 on the Edmonton 49. Quickly on the far side of the field, they'll go to Bailey. And Bailey got one block along the way and takes it down inside the Edmonton 45.
Targeted a few times in the first half, Rasheed Bailey. See, Jonathan Mincy has to fight off a block out there by Dembski and then get Bailey out of bounds.
Second and 4 on Winnipeg offense. They have a 5-point lead as we near the midway point of the third quarter at Commonwealth. Three receivers to the left here for Kolaris. He's just going to toss it out. Oliveira's got the first down a little bit more. And he's taken down awfully close to the Edmonton 35. Man, they have not missed a beat with this kid in at running back.
Well, just love the formation, too. They go tight end to the field. So there's where they think that Edmonton will think they're going to run. But what they're going to run to the short side, and Oliveira's going to get on that quick pitch. He's going to get the edge real quickly. Kenny Lawler comes down to block up the edge, make it a hot edge so that Oliveira can get outside.
Morgan over there on the tackle. Fresh set of downs for Kolaris. This one high, looking for Lawler. Looked like Lawler might have got a hand on it, but it'll fall incomplete and bring up second and 10.
Well, this is interesting because this second and 10 so crucial right now in the third quarter. And see what if Noel Thorpe dials up another blitz and if Zach Kolaris can beat it. If he doesn't, does Michael O'Shea decide to kick a field goal from that distance with Ali Mortado, who's been good tonight, but a bit of an adventure this season.
Hasn't hit one from outside 40 yet. It's time with the Bombers. Kolaris pressure just throws it up. Oliveira got it, but then he got absolutely popped by Bieria.
So here we go. Noel Thorpe decides that's exactly what we're going to do this time. We're going to bring the linebacker and show blitz and then drop him out. And guess which linebacker is going to make the tackle on this little play to Oliveira. Here he goes. He's up in front. Keyshawn Bieria. He drops out. A show blitz executed excellent by the Elks.
They will attempt the field goal. 43-yarder. Mortada is 0 for 6 outside of 40 so far this year, but not this time. Mortada knocks it home in Winnipeg, finally finding some consistency in their kicking game. Well, it's
been a tough year for Darrell Walker, and this is him after that last ball that was underthrown by Cornelius. Very frustrated. For more on Walker, let's send it down to Ryan Rashad.
Yeah, Dustin, frustrated is a fair word to describe Darrell Walker this season. Said it's been one of his most frustrating. You know, it's off the football field with all the restrictions and COVID that builds into it. It's the record and the team not being where he wants. But he did admit it's about the amount that he's being relied on by this football team. Listen, he's getting targeted a fair amount, but consider this. Coming into this game, in 20 plays in the red zone, Darrell Walker has been targeted twice this season without a touchdown. He says he wishes he was put in position more often to contribute in a meaningful way. So he still believes in the group. He believes in this young quarterback. He's trying to stay positive, but guys, he made no bones about the fact he is frustrated about not being used enough.
1,000-yard season with Toronto in 2019. And Ryan mentioned, I mean, he's been targeting 23 targets in his last three games, coming in at 7 catches.
Well, and a way he can get rid of that frustration is do this. When he's not the target, the initial target is to step up and try and get physical with defensive backs. But, you know, I'll mention on the target discussion, those two in the last series, one way over his head and one hot. He was targeted twice there with no chance to catch it.
So, can't blame him.
Yeah.
Here's Cornelius on the run. There is a flag deep down the field. Cornelius all the way. And he does have a completion. But as I mentioned, a flag, three flags actually, out by the Winnipeg 50.
How about Richie Hall's defensive schemes where they can...
Winnipeg. 10-yard penalty. Makes it a first down.
No wonder Taylor Cornelius thought it was a fast break. They had too many out there. But you often feel that way with this defense because of the guys up front. Willie Jefferson moves from his defensive end spot into the tackle spot, and he's the guy who got Cornelius on the run. Richie Hall's got their group working at a high level.
Nice mix of veterans and young guys who come in and made significant impacts this year. And Alford and Nichols working back there with Alexander in the secondary. First and 10 on the 45 for Cornelius. And he's going to drop it off to Ellingson. Ellingson to the 45, puts his head down and took a pop, but rolled off of it up towards the 50.
Dedrick Nichols is going to come up and help out in run support. Greg Ellingson had to really bubble back there with Jefferson up the field.
Second and 6, big down here for Cornelius. There's Darrell Walker, he's got him this time, reading the numbers, and Walker will hang on and take it down to the Winnipeg 50.
Blitz up at the line of scrimmage, Walker in a one-on-one in the ISO on Dedrick Alford, and comes back on that curl. DeAndre Alford in good position to make the tackle, but not knock it down.
36 tackles on the year for Alford coming into the game tonight. First and 10 on the Winnipeg 50. They'll give it to Fletcher, and Fletcher will secure the ball. Jefferson tried to knock it out of there, but Wilder will now come in, and Fletcher will head over to the sideline.
I'm giving Walter Fletcher a couple of reps there, but pretty good first half for James Wilder. I'm a little surprised that they don't just stick with Wilder, although he may have been just getting something straightened away on the sideline and had to miss one play.
9 carries for 34 yards in the first half for Wilder. Cornelius, he's going to look down the field.
Greg Ellingson, and this is a blitz beater if he can get it there. It's a matter of getting it there on time, though. The blitz is picked up nicely. The Bombers going with a lot of pressure, and there's Ellingson in the corner right on the numbers. 36-yard gain and a big one for Taylor Cornelius. Boy, he dropped that with great accuracy.
Sets them up at the Winnipeg 11, down by 8 here as we creep towards the final moments of quarter number 3. Cornelius across to Shai Ross. Ross staying on his feet to the end zone. Touchdown Edmonton. As Edmonton
effort from Shy Ross. Little play action just to hold pursuit from the linebackers from the inside out. That's a play that is often run down from a guy like Adam Big Hill. But if you run the play action first, you hold Big Hill and the linebacking core in there, and you make it a one-on-one for your receiver and DBs on the outside, and Shy Ross got it done.
And the offense will stay out here and go for two. It's a 16-14 game, seven play, 75-yard drive. The big pickup to Greg Ellingson. Cornelius looking to tie it. Down, but there's a flag on the play. Was Tolliver kind of tripped as he went to make a play on that ball?
Well, it's back there in the end zone.
Cornelius.
And Kim Croker, the head official, trying to get the call from the back judge.
Pass interference, Winnipeg number 45. Retry the convert from the 1 yard line.
Alfred in the back of the end zone. It might have been accidental. Little slant route. Number 45 on the coverage and a little accidental trip.
Krukoff into the game.
Well, that's the ruling on the field right now. Every scoring play, including converts, will be reviewed. And right now, Brandon Alexander is arguing that the play continued. Krukoff didn't get there yet, and the play continued, and then Alexander or someone in there stripped the ball from Krukoff just prior to the signal from the official that it was a convert. So I'm not sure if there's anything that Michael Shea could see here to challenge and try and overturn, although it's an automatic challenge. But you see the ball loose and on the floor prior to that signal by the official.
That is awfully close. As for now, we are tied at 16. Shy Ross to the end zone again. Get that man a cookie. Back flipping after the touchdown. Late in the third quarter, we are tied at 16. Shy Ross.
Hey, Mama, that's
been involved in the offense quite a bit this season. He's made some big plays for this team. That was another one of them. Yeah. Grant on the return will take that out to about the 32. Another look at Shy Ross's work.
Well, he gets the ball so quickly here from Taylor Cornelius on this little screen, and then now he's got a chance to really set up a block and break a tackle. It was Alden Darby that came from inside out to get there, and then you go to the two-point convert, and even though the signal was a little late from the official, it looked like Krukoff did cross the plane right about there before he lost the football. So the correct call made on the two-point convert.
Winnipeg starts in their own 31. Alvira again. Nice cutback. And that is enough for another first down. And the 14th overall pick in the 2019 draft going to work here in the second half. 13 more.
Week one, when he got a chance to play with Andrew Harris on the injured list. Oliveira was the best back in the CFL that week.
Roger Hart.
In his very first start.
Nice way to burst onto the scene. 69 yards on the night for Oliveira.
They'll go back to him again. A little hesitation, found a hole and pushes ahead for close to five on first down.
That's nice patience for a young player. Here's a guy that wants to hit the hole as hard as he can, but he's learned from his mentor and Andrew Harris and showed great patience when he got the football to find his hole, let it develop, and then pick up pretty good yards on first down.
As a team, they've rushed for over 130 yards after putting up 150 from Harris last week against Edmonton. It's been a recipe for success. Polaris here on second down, looking down the field, and that is batted away, and there are no flags. It was Moncrief in coverage, 10 on 10 there as he worked against Nick Dembski.
Pressure again from Noel Thorpe. He's been dialing up a lot of blitzes and trying to get Zach Collaros to throw when he's not comfortable throwing and doesn't want to get it out of there. You see, he couldn't even step into that, although he did give it a chance. But Nick Dembski, who lines up at that three receiver spot, that means Moncrief, the linebacker's in a one-on-one, and Moncrief gets there.
Kick away cleanly, wobbling a bit. Williams will take it at the 22. And he's got nowhere to go. Cadwaller all the way down the field quickly. Wrapped up Williams before he could get anything going with less than a minute to go in the third quarter. Jamie Elizondo with his quarterback in a big spot here has a lot of confidence in this kid.
The kid played at Oklahoma State. So he's played at some big environments. And so he just doesn't get two up or two down. And that's going to be a good thing for us right now, so that as a team on the sideline, we can stay even keeled. And that's been one of the problems for us over the last couple weeks is, you know, how we respond when we're struck with adversity.
Cornelius, tight window there. He found Greg Ellington, who got up and wanted to take off, but that'll be another first down. And you know, it's interesting with Cornelius and, you know, hearing Jamie talk about him. He was in a situation where he had a lead against Winnipeg in his first game, and then the Winnipeg defense got to him, and he's in a similar situation to see if he's taking that next step here tonight.
See four defenders around Greg Ellington there, and he threaded the needle.
First and 10. Cornelius looking for somewhere to go. Eventually sprung it outside, and it's maybe a yard on the play. And he comes up with a little bit of a limp, but he's got himself in a ball game here against the first place Winnipeg Blue Bombers, 16-16 after three quarters. Don't go anywhere. We've got an excellent finish to Friday Night Football coming up here on TSN. Winnipeg has been on a roll so far this season, winning 8 of 9. They've won 6 in a row. Edmonton has lost 4 in a row, but here we are, tied at 16 through three quarters. What stands out for you?
Well, what stands out is both defenses playing well. We've seen some real good things from Taylor Cornelius, even though they're playing against a great defense in Winnipeg, and seeing this Edmonton defense play with this blitz package and making it uncomfortable for Zach Collaros. Remember, this Winnipeg team has outscored teams in the last couple of games like 60-16. And we got a tie game going into the fourth. Remember, this is the best quarter for the Bombers all season long, especially on defense. They're allowing those two field goals all year. Let's see if Taylor Cornelius can solve that puzzle.
This Bombers defense, a good throughout the entire season in every aspect, but in the fourth quarter, they have been near perfect. Cornelius now, he comes around Walker, and Walker drops this one right in his hands.
And for young receivers, and this one's going to be right over where he goes talk to Taylor Cornelius. So remember, we showed you how frustrated he got, and he let it get to him when he was missed by Taylor Cornelius twice on back-to-back plays in the third quarter. That just carried over to now him dropping a perfect throw on the other.
Neal with a pretty good kick. Grant will take this just inside his own 20. Denarian Grant tries to cut it back up the middle to about the 25-yard line, and that is where the Bombers will go to work.
There it is.
Dominant.
That has been absolute dominance. 81-6.
Now we've got some pushing and shoving here. Just inside the 40, it looks like the officials will have this separated. Darvin Adams in the mix. Haven't really mentioned his name tonight. Does not have a catch. I did watch the sideline there. Walker gone and sat down on the bench, and Cornelius came over to him, stopped him a couple of times, said, "Let's go."
Yeah, another sack. I mean, they've both taken their turns now, so now they'll work when they get the ball back. We'll see how long that'll be.
Best fourth quarter team in the Canadian Football League. Tied at 16 here, about to go to work. Pressure coming close, dumps it off over the top. Olaire's got it. And back to the line of scrimmage, maybe even a loss of a yard on the play.
So Thomas Koskin, remember, he was in the middle of that late hit that was overturned, and a good challenge by Jamie Elizondo, but great hustle from inside out. His defensive line play, he went after the passer, but then quickly pivoted and got over there to make that tackle.
Second and 11 now. Opelaris just shy of 60% on completion so far in this game. Has a touchdown and a pick. Second and long. Gets this one away. And that one will be caught by Darvin Adams, who we're just talking about, but it will not be even close to enough for a first down, and they will have to kick this thing away again with Mark Leggio.
Niles Morgan drops underneath what Kolaris wanted. We'll take a look again at the play. It looked like it may have been dropped. Yeah, that was using the turf to assist in the catch.
Third and four. Leggio standing at his own 22 as he lets this fire. Williams hustling over, wanting to get under it. Bounces once, and he'll take it on the hop. 45-yard kick. And he gets forced back down inside the 30. Has nothing opening up for Edmonton on return game. Houston making his Bombers debut tonight here in the Canadian Football League, and nobody would have blamed him if he rushed home back in early August when his 12-year-old daughter back home in Charlotte, North Carolina, was hit by a stray bullet that came right through their house. He was on the phone with his wife, Ashley, and she said, "Our daughter's been shot," and he thought he was talking about a video game. She says, "No, she's been shot. There was a bunch of bullets shot at the neighbor's house. 10 went into that house, one went into his. Daughter was taken to hospital. She ended up being okay, but he's moved his family up to Winnipeg. He's got three kids, his wife, they're all in Winnipeg now, but that's a stunning story for DeMario Houston.
Well, just so glad that his daughter is okay, and that he's got him close and safe, and, you know, wow, it just sort of brings home, transits way beyond the game, but good for him to get his family up next to him and close to him. His daughter is fine, which is great news, and he's played a very good, solid football game. You know why I know? Because we haven't talked about him.
I was just gonna say,
yeah.
It's been a quiet night, and we haven't had to talk about him yet. So good for him and his family now, all together in Winnipeg. Obviously eases his mind a little bit. Here's Cornelius trying to find Wilder on second down and eight, and that comes up incomplete, and this will be kicked away by Edmonton.
Yeah, he's in playing in for Nick Taylor, who was a last-second scratch. You know, one thing I'm enjoying watching from Taylor Cornelius tonight is his desire and effort to keep plays alive. He really is trying to, you know, fight through each play, avoid that rush, take some hits, take off and run when he needs to.
Another kick from O'Neill. Grant takes it just inside his own 35, a 42-yard kick to Darian Grant. Staying on his feet, works it back up just inside the 45, and that is where Winnipeg will have the ball once again. Deadlocked at 16 in Edmonton.
You literally don't have to. talk.
I
talk a little shit, of course. But you don't ever have to prove nothing to anybody that these feet don't do.
Ah! Ah! That's why you need to go! That's why you need to go! Let's go!
Don't miss a new episode of CFL Wire, bringing you exclusive access to the latest CFL football highlights. Catch it Tuesday at 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific, only on TSN. And we had a couple of thrilling finishes last week in the Canadian Football League. And, hey, we got another one possibly coming up here with just over 11 minutes left and tied at 16 between the first place Bombers and the last place Elks. Just waiting for Winnipeg has been so good in the fourth quarter. He's put together that drive, right? And
all right, let's keep it
going. I haven't seen it yet.
He's a big part of those drives you're talking about that we're used to seeing.
Rivera done a very nice job filling in for Harris, who was hurt on the touchdown that he got earlier in the game. Flores this time.
Kidding me, you don't get many opportunities like that one. Wow, he cannot believe it, and I don't blame him. I mean, I'm not sure Zach Collaros feels the pressure. I mean, I think he may be seeing some shadows here and throws it out there. He really didn't have a target all that close to that throw. A communication issue, but that hit Aaron Grimes right in the chest, and he was thinking 6 points before he secured the catch.
12 career interceptions. That would have been number 13, but unlucky. Now Collaros down the field. He's got a man wide open, and it's going to be taken by Bailey. Grimes will track him down, but Bailey takes it inside the 20. How's that for a turn of events?
Wow. Right down the same zone of Aaron Grimes, who chases him down, and you see how he tried to punch that ball out because he's so frustrated, because this play not compounds the mistake on the dropped interception. Sheed Bailey right down the seam in Aaron Grimes' zone. He tried to punch it out, couldn't get it out of there. 48-yarder.
Wow.
Pressure again on Zach Collaros. I think he's had more pressure. That was borderline late.
Inside the 20. Oliveira right up the gut. Shedding a couple of tackles. Still going down inside the 10. He's got a first down.
Oh, nice. Nice vision. Nice patience. Bounce in the hole. Let it set up. Don't run right into the back of your center or your guard. Just let it set up. Bounce inside. Another bounce to the outside. It's kind of like Boateng had him and lost him.
Oliveira this time tied up. Broke one tackle and then got down to the 5.
It was down in this end. Andrew Harris was injured early, and he really hasn't, we haven't seen a lot of trainer discussion or treatment over there. I think it's more precautionary, speculating a little there, but hasn't returned since scoring a touchdown in this very end, the first half.
Second and goal from the 5 for Collaros. He's going to send one to the corner. Touchdown as he finds Rasheed Bailey for his fourth touchdown of the season. And the drive finished here in the fourth quarter by Winnipeg.
When you're playing a great football team, and the Bombers are a great football team, you just can't give them second chances. Aaron Grimes gave the Bombers offense a second chance, and Zach Collaros went to work, hit Bailey down the seam, hit Bailey to finish the drive, a couple of runs mixed in. You cannot give the best team in the league a second chance.
Put some respect on my name!
I respect him very much. He's having a terrific season.
Looks like he's playing mad tonight.
Having a good game, having a good year. Extra point from Murtada. Speaking of good games tonight, he's had a good game. Aaron Grimes, this could have gone the other way. He's the most experienced member of the Edmonton defense. And this drive, a lot of it on him. Finished by Bailey. Bombers on top.
It's Take you back to that Rashid Bailey touchdown, and just he's going to run the corner here in combination route with his partner Darvin Adams, and at the mesh point, that's where the confusion is caused for the secondary for the Edmonton Elks. See, right in here, now they've got to decide, who do you have, who do I have? Is it Darvin Adams or Bailey? Bailey shoots through deep, uncovered.
And now Edmonton will have to try to do something that nobody else has done all year, and that is score 7 points against Winnipeg in the fourth quarter. Here goes Terry Williams. Williams finds an open room to the outside. There's a flag go down at the 50. And Williams will take this back up to the 40. A pretty good return, but about halfway into it, there's a flag, and it's against Edmonton.
Hey, man. In life, you're going to press.
There's a return holding Edmonton number 29. 10-yard penalty, first down.
Darius Williams, the guilty individual.
It's not been a lot of penalties by either team in this one, but
it's a huge swing here.
That is a in the
penalty applied from 15-yard line, half the distance.
That falls under the category of the worst timing department for the Elks in their quest to answer that touchdown drive after a good return. Now they're back in the shadow of their goalpost.
Another opportunity to see what Taylor Cornelius is made of. This one would have been up right around the 40.
Yeah.
And instead, they start inside their own 10.
Huge, huge penalty.
On the 7-yard line with just over 8 minutes to go. Cornelius will give it to Wilder, and Wilder, a pretty good push, still going. And he's taken down just inside the 15. Not as much involved in the second half as we thought he might be. He gets almost 8 yards there.
Yeah, it really is interesting that he just has not got many touches in this second half after a real good first half, but that's his second of the second half.
Sets up second and 3. Cornelius to Vaughn Smith, stays on his feet, stumbles ahead, and he's got the first down. They almost stopped him short, but he pushes ahead just outside the 20.
Again, I can't emphasize enough how Taylor Cornelius is giving his receivers a chance. I thought this was going to be a blow-up hit. It looked so close. But it got there so quickly that Tavon Smith had a chance to break that tackle.
First and 10 on the 20. A little bit of breathing room after starting this drive on the 7. Cornelius again. Pressure right up the middle. They're going to get there this time. Taking him down. It's Adam.
All kinds of attention up front. Tyler Higbee is in there playing at guard, and he's going to get caught. He's going to get caught looking down here. Big Hill's coming around that block. Double team on the inside on Jake Thomas, and Big Hill delayed blitz gets there.
Second sack of the year for Big Hill. A touchdown here at Commonwealth in week 7. Cornelius, second and 15. Trouble again. They're going to get there again. This time it's Willie Jefferson, his 7th sack of the year. Winnipeg defense coming up big here in the fourth quarter.
Well, this is just a flat mismatch. Tavon Smith, right here, is supposed to block Willie Jefferson right there.
Uh-oh.
I don't like number 4's chances. And he's got some help with Justin Renfrew as well. And number 5 got past both of them.
And Cornelius had stepped up. Jefferson right on target.
Hey, Mama, I love you, Daddy. Daddy, man, 4-9, man. I love you, man. You already know I don't shout you out all the time, man. I love you, dog. Keep on.
And that is Renfrew being helped off the field. And Big Hill and
Jefferson. We talked so much about this defense with Jeff Cook and Jefferson and Big Hill. And sure enough, those two guys make back-to-back huge plays. And now Grant will secure that ball and lunge ahead just over the Edmonton 50. An excellent field position here for Winnipeg to come out and maybe put together a drive to seal this thing away.
Yeah. Put their foot to the pedal, and this is where they would run the ball 6, 7, 8 times, finish with a touchdown. Harris would add 70 yards to his totals. This is what happened last week. And this time it's Brady Oliveira. But boy, what a turn of events. And Aaron Grimes will see that in his nightmares probably for the rest of the season.
Oliveira, if they do want to run it to put this game away. Takes it down just inside the 45.
Let's take you back to the second quarter, and this was with Andrew Harris. If you're just joining us, this is what happened. He got hurt. It just looked like he twisted in a strange way catching this right there, stumbled in, got the touchdown, counted. He was met by the training staff, really didn't talk to the training staff on the sideline, but at halftime put on the street clothes, the sweatpants, and has not returned, so get more reports during the week.
Second and 6, Oliveira again trying to pick his way towards a first down, and he's gonna be a couple of yards shy, maybe 3, as he couldn't find his way to the 40.
Well, it's been a pretty good night for Ali Mortada. And with the inconsistency we've seen with the kicking game throughout the year for Winnipeg,
they're gonna punt it.
I think Michael O'Shea is gonna go with the punt here instead of the long field goal. When you get the long field goal attempt, if you miss it, you've got bigger guys trying to cover.
3rd and 3. Williams looks confused.
Timeout, Edmonton.
And now Edmonton is gonna be forced to call a timeout in this situation with just over 4 minutes left. Timeout that could have been valuable maybe later in the game, but it certainly looked like some confusion there for Terry Williams.
Well, I'll tell you, this, I mean, this is definitely field goal range.
You gotta bring it out, you gotta go.
So Edmonton calls a timeout to make sure that Williams has the instructions that if it does go in the end zone, they want to bring it out of the end zone. I think you're going to try to angle this and keep it in or out of bounds, but out of the end zone as well.
Maggio in midfield.
Yep.
Looking for that corner. And Williams will bring it out. Williams up to the 10, to the 11. And that's as far as he gets. A 43-yard kick from Mark Leggio. Nice piece of work there.
And the Elks still can't buy a return. And one of the reasons for it is Mike Miller on the cover teams, who's just going to just fight and get up and fight some more and get up and find, like, just a brawl to get down there. Top special teams tackler in the league. Top special teams tackler all time since they started recording special teams tackles.
20 special team tackles for Miller coming into the game tonight. Another crack at it here for Cornelius. Quickly, he'll get that into the hands of Tolliver, who's chopped down after a short pickup. Let's send it down to Ryan Rashad.
Okay, guys, we're going to keep a close eye on Taylor Cornelius and the mobility. We saw her late in the third quarter. He came up limp after a play. I can tell you on the sidelines, he's been stretching out that right leg a lot. He's been digging at it. They definitely got to him a couple times in their last possession. A little bit more elusive earlier in the game, so we'll see how he's moving here.
Big part of the game for him, no doubt. Now this one almost picked off the other way as Cornelius on the far side, and there he is. We talked about him a little bit earlier. Demario Houston would have had 6.
Looked like it was an out route by Ellingson. And I thought that might have been tipped at the line of scrimmage too, but yeah, he cut underneath in that zone look. Well, one drop for each team in the DB department. This is where people say, that's why you're a DB.
It's all even, I guess, in that department, but the Bombers lead 23-16 in Commonwealth. Friday Night Football on TSN is proudly presented by The Brick, saving you more. Just under 3 minutes left here in Edmonton. And O'Neill set to kick it away on 3rd and 7. And from his 5, he'll let it fly. And Arian Grant takes it at his own 50. 45-yard kick, Grant up the near sideline, tiptoeing along there, takes it down. Close to the Edmonton 45. The outs will say it was back a little bit further, but I don't think they're going to win that discussion.
You know, Janarian Grant has looked good tonight, and it just feels like he's back and completely healthy again. Won't be surprised if you see him break one in the next couple of weeks. But a good return to. Put Zach Collaros in a first down away from range to make it a two-possession game.
Collaros will tuck it into the belly of Bailey. Bailey makes one man miss. Rolls ahead just inside the 35. And I like the way that they've got Rashid Bailey involved in this offense tonight.
Yeah, these fly sweeps have been mixed in nicely. The timing of them is great, and you have to get contained from your defensive end here, or it's not gonna happen. And Brady Oliveira does the job of keeping contained away. That was Thomas Costigan, and allowing Bailey to get outside.
Yards rushing tonight for Winnipeg. On the Edmonton 33. Oliveira stood up this time, and that'll bring up the second down. This is a big one with just over 2 minutes left.
Well, Noel Thorpe has had a pretty good blitz package in this game tonight. And I won't be surprised if he loads the line of scrimmage, because it's good against the run too if Zach Collaros and Buck Pierce decide to go with a draw play or a run play. They're in field goal range, but there has been inconsistency, as you know, and we've talked about it, in the field goal department. So huge down, keep it to one possession.
Ball from 22 on second down this evening. Collaros. The snap goes down to pick it up and takes a loss on the play. Not how they drew it up.
Well, that just made it a longer kick.
Looked like it was Edmonton.
Yeah, that was just dropped by Zach Collaros, and looked like Oliveira was supposed to either take that play or maybe go play action there, but.
Christian Rector was there to finish him off after he picked it back up, being consoled by Harris.
How about the look of Michael O'Shea trying to make the decision here?
Well, Mortada, by far the best night of his young career. 3 for 3 from 37, 27, and 43. This one, 43 yards as well to increase the cushion. From the left hash for Ali Mortada. This one is out. Mortada has pushed it wide right. Williams has got it, and he's going to bring it out at the 5. Williams back to the 10, gets out to the 15 before he's tossed out of bounds. And kicking possibly factoring into this thing again tonight for Winnipeg.
Well, it's one possession, and it gives the Elks a chance with 1:42 left. Take a look at the Snap, kick, and hold. That's Sean McGuire, the backup quarterback. Snap, ideal. Hold looks excellent. Last week, the Bombers beat Edmonton 30-3. I listened to the call-in show driving home, and all I heard from Bomber fans was, we've got to make a trade for a kicker. Now, he's had a better night tonight, a good night tonight, but that makes it a two possession and basically ends this game if he makes it. Doesn't. And it's opened up a door, a crack.
He did hit one from outside 40 tonight, but coming into the game, he was 0 for 5 from outside 40, 0 for 1 from outside 50. I think he got a rough ride at the end of this play as well. Battling with Rose. They put up a fight.
Well, on a missed field goal, you know, the special teams coaches will coach one player to be designated to the kicker, because the kicker, how many times has made that final tackle on a big return?
So clear him out now.
Clear him out right away, absolutely.
Another crack at it here for Taylor Cornelius. Down 7 with a 1:42 on the clock. Friday Night Football on TSN. Cornelius looking for Walker. The timing on that one was off, as Walker had turned just as that ball flew by him.
You know, when Taylor Cornelius got pushed out of bounds and he came up limping a little bit, he looks like he's favoring that leg. He just didn't step into that throw. You're right, there was a timing issue, but he looks like a different guy.
178 yards for Cornelius. Team trails 23-16. Dumps it off to Walker. Walker pushing. He lowered down to go for the first down. And he bounces right back up. The defender remains down. That's Dietrich Nichols.
Boy, that was solid contact. There's a little mobility with the knee issue for Cornelius, but listen to this and watch that contact. Wow. This was Darrell Walker lowering his pad.
Less than 90 seconds to play. Cornelius pressured. They're going to get there. He gets the ball away, but it's up and incomplete. And the Winnipeg defense in the face, forcing the turnover on downs, as Cornelius really never had time.
Well, straight drop back. I know you need a couple of chunks, but you got third and one. Jake Thomas is going to get the pressure with a great bull rush. Pride of New Brunswick, along with his buddy Mike Miller.
Jeff Coat came over to help him finish off Cornelius.
Another East Coaster.
Hope everyone's all back home.
There you go, saying hi back to the East Coast. Not sure about that play call.
Third and one. Pressure that Winnipeg front four can bring.
Well, I might have just got the first. You get, you know, even if you lose 5 seconds, you got 1:15 in a new set.
Still have time, you're right.
Yeah. I know, it's easy to second guess. And if he completes a 15-yard throw, we're saying gutsy call, nice throw, and
he's never really had time to set for the throw. You got a big back like Wilder, though. I know a lot of people will be talking about that here
exactly,
in Edmonton, right?
Exactly.
He's a big guy.
Exactly.
You only needed a yard to at least continue to give yourself a shot in this game as the clock ticks down inside 60. And the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, who have been so good in the fourth quarter this season, are on the verge of shutting down another opponent. Oliveira over 100 yards in this game.
coming in place of Andrew Harris.
Yeah, we haven't even, the football has not been on this side of the field, let alone Winnipeg giving up points in the fourth quarter.
The closest it was Grimes when he dropped that interception.
Yeah, Edmonton has not, and that would have been, by the way, a score against the offense.
Yeah, that's true.
Not a score against the Winnipeg defense. But Grimes dropped it, gave him another chance, got the go-ahead touchdown. Zach Collaros, give him a second chance and he'll make you pay. And
speaking of another chance, Mortada.
He's had a couple of another chances.
23-yarder, and that one is good. And that will push the lead to 10 for Winnipeg. 26-16 the score with 28 seconds on the clock.
Yeah, good, but he kind of knuckled it. And I'm not sure the kicking issue is behind the Bombers just yet.
Well, they stuck with him through a couple of tough weeks. I think Coach O'Shea talked about how he does like his mechanics.
Yeah, he says he kicks well in practice, and you know, when they put pressure on him as much as you can in a practice, and he says really, really consistent, and he wants to give him the opportunity to work his way out of this. Had to make some adjustments. When he went 0-3 in the first game, he felt like it was more of adjusting from the alignment from hash marks in Canadian football instead of American football.
Right in that.
The same way, yeah. So, you know, he kind of wrote that off to just alignment. But I tell you what, if the West Final comes down to a field goal from 48 yards in late November,
you'd like to have, for starters, a more experienced
kicker,
you know, in that situation. But
trade deadline is October 27th. I'm not trying to trade a kicker here. I'm just saying.
Williams bobbles it. Fletcher picks it up. Drops it back to Ellingson as they try to make something work. That ball's going to pop loose. And it's scooped up, pushing ahead towards the five. And our sports betting friends, very, very interested in that as the spread coming in. I think, yeah, it was 12. So that would have been interesting. Yeah. 14 seconds left. That was almost a greasy cover. Winnipeg doing what Winnipeg does. I mean, when teams give them their best punch, they find a way to get it done, and they did it again here.
Yeah, this game came down to about 3 minutes in the fourth quarter when,
let's run this bitch,
at a tie game, Aaron Grimes dropped a pick six. It was a straight pick six. Gave Zach Collaros a second chance. He hit Bailey twice, once down the seam on Grimes, and then a corner route for a touchdown, the go-ahead touchdown. That was the football game.
Victory formation once again for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. How many of you are getting used to us saying that? As O'Shea has Winnipeg cruising along nicely.
Thank you.
Huge moment in this ballgame once again. Aaron Grimes is going to want this back.
Tied at 16. Aaron Grimes had this. Nothing in front of him. Ball right between the three and the six. He can't hang on. And after that miss, Collaros was five plays to the end zone. And that was ball game. 9-1, Bombers.
Beaten deep on the very next play as the Winnipeg Blue Bombers continue to control the West. They've officially clinched a playoff spot. First, obviously, theirs for the taking as well. Bombers have won seven in a row. Take all three meetings against Edmonton this year, and it's a dominant fourth quarter as the story continues in Winnipeg, a team that is extremely difficult to get anything against in the fourth quarter. Thank you for joining us. Let's send it to SportsCenter next.